Talk about good press. And you'd be forgiven for questioning what CNN left out of the finished product that we might have liked to see. Now, she rocked up to the interview with her vice presidential pick, Tim Walz, and he was there silently most of the time, like some sort of emotional support candidate, and they occasionally shared awkward glances at each other. But Harris wants to be the first female president of the United States, and she's up against a man in Donald Trump who lacks no confidence, who doesn't hide from interviews, who doesn't struggle to speak off script, and always appears strong. He's big, he's bold, he's brash, you know, the sort of things that you'd want in someone charged with defending the free world. But Harris rocked up with her mate. A bit like when HR calls you in to tell you you've been terminated and you can take a support person in with you. Not that I know from experience, I've always been a good boy. But you never know, the day may come. But it was like she needed someone there to hold her hand, someone to back her up. It made her look weak. If you want to be the President of the United States, surely you can do an interview, especially your first, by yourself. So it means one of two things. Either she can't hack it, or she thinks that having Walz with her boosts her brand. And she fell at the first hurdle. Now, you saw the clip before, but we're going to play it again. Dana Bash handed up the easiest question in the history of political interviews. What would you do on day one as president? At least it should be easy if you have a policy agenda, but Harris couldn't give a straight answer.
If you are elected, what would you do on day one in the White House?
Well, there are a number of things. I will tell you, first and foremost, one of my highest priorities is to do what we can to support and strengthen the middle class. When I look at the aspirations, the goals, the ambitions of the American people, I think that people are ready for a new way forward.
So Bash tried again, and it went just as well.
So what would you do day one?
Day one, it's going to be about, one, implementing my plan for what I call an opportunity economy. I've already laid out a number of proposals in that regard, which include what we're going to do to bring down the cost of everyday goods, what we're going to do to invest in America's small businesses, what we're going to do to invest in families. So there are a number of things on day one.
She finally managed to get one policy out of her mouth, one, after dancing around it with motherhood statements and saying she'd announced many different measures. I mean, supporting the middle class isn't something you do on day one. It's the result of policies that you might implement on day one. You know, build the wall, cut income tax, whatever it is, you should have a grab bag of policies at the ready that you want to drop on day one. Trump's already said his. He said, close the border and drill, drill, drill. But Harris could barely think up a single policy. Then she was asked about the fact that record numbers of illegal migrants have poured across the southern border under Joe Biden's presidency and, of course, her vice presidency. And she basically said it's all good because the numbers are down a bit.
During the Biden-Harris administration, there were record numbers of illegal border crossings. Why did the Biden-Harris administration wait 3.5 years to implement sweeping asylum restrictions?
Well, first of all, the root causes work that I did as vice president, that I was asked to do by the president, has actually resulted in a number of benefits, including historic investments by American businesses in that region. The number of immigrants coming from that region has actually reduced since we began that work.
All good then. And how about the fact that she once wanted to decriminalise the border, but has now promised to bring back the border security bill that was killed in the Senate last year that would expand the border wall?
There's one other question about something that you said in 2019 when you first ran. There was a debate. You raised your hand when asked whether or not the border should be decriminalised. Do you still believe that?
I believe there should be consequence. We have laws that have to be followed and enforced, that address and deal with people who cross our border illegally, and there should be consequence. And let's be clear, in this race, I'm the only person who has prosecuted transnational criminal organizations who traffic in guns, drugs, and human beings. I'm the only person in this race who actually served a border state as attorney general to enforce our laws, and I would enforce our laws as president going forward. I recognize the problem.
So she's the only one who prosecuted border traffickers. What does that matter? We all know Trump isn't a lawyer or a prosecutor. He sure as hell had tighter control of the border when he was president. I mean, he shut the border and Biden reopened it as one of his first acts as president. So for Harris to portray herself as tough on illegal migration because she helped lock up a few Mexican gangsters a few years ago is a bit rich. But she, of course, knows that the flood of illegal migration under her and Biden's watch is on the nose with voters, and she has to pivot. Immigration is rated as the number one issue in America, above the economy, and a majority of Americans, according to polling, support the border wall. And remember, she was meant to be the border czar, but she's only visited the place once in the past 4 years. So she has a bit of catching up to do in looking tough. But as the interview wore on, short as it was, Harris eventually veered off into her trademark word salad.
I'm talking about an era that started about a decade ago, where there is some suggestion, warped, I believe it to be, that the measure of the strength of a leader is based on who you beat down, instead of where I believe most Americans are, which is to believe that the true measure of the strength of a leader is based on who you lift up. That's what's at stake as much as any other detail that we could discuss in this election.
Is that leader, though, unburdened by what has been? I mean, this is why she's only done one interview so far, a sit-down that was pre-recorded and edited with someone holding her hand, and it's probably why she won't do many more. That's why it only went for 27 minutes. And Waltz was occasionally allowed to pipe up, including when he was asked about fabricating his military record.
The idea that you said that you were in war. Yeah. Did you misspeak, as the campaign has said?
Yeah, I said we were talking about, in this case, this was after a school shooting, the ideas of carrying these weapons of war. And my wife, the English teacher, told me my grammar's not always correct. But again, if it's not this, it's an attack on my children for showing love for me, or it's an attack on my dog. I'm not going to do that. And the one thing I'll never do is I'll never demean another member's service in any way. I never have, and I never will.
I mean, please, the grammar. In 2018, he said, quote, "We can make sure that those weapons of war that I carried in war is the only place where those weapons are at." Now, yes, the grammar is pretty poor, but using the words "weapons of war that I carried in war" when you didn't serve a single day in combat seems pretty clear-cut to me. And to draw the thing to a close on a nice note, they were both handed softball questions about their families. I think the best thing I can say about that interview is that of all the political interviews I've watched in my life, that was one of them. It was completely unremarkable. It wasn't hard-hitting, it was shorter than a good shower, and Harris fumbled the most basic questions. But it just about summed her up. Light on substance, heavy on feelings.